Hello and welcome to the JfG Podcast. My name is Alex, and I'm not joined by my good friend Ash because he is on holiday, buddies. So this is just going to be me for the first, I don't know, three quarters of this show. And then after that, hopefully, because Ash is due back the day before this recording is supposed to go live on the internets for your pleasure, Ash will be able to join in his triumphant return from his Holishlay. He can fill us all in, buddies, tell us what he's been up to, and so on. But until then, let's get on with the show. Hopefully this will be not too weird, not too shit, and I don't know how long it will be either. But, you know, we'll get there. It'll be fine. So yes, very briefly, what I've been up to, I have been having a lovely week. I had a barbecue in this wonderful weather. We made some sort of cheeky chicken skewers, buddies. It was a gorgeous thing. Very enjoyable indeed. And, you know, some of that Schwartz. Is it Schwartz or Schwarzkopf? One of them's a seasoning and one of them's a hairspray. I'm not sure which one's which, but we used the seasoning rather than the hairspray. And very tasty indeed they were. Very nice barbecue, lovely weather we've been having here in England. It's a rarity, I will say that. It is a rarity. What else have I been up to? I went to the cinema, I saw the new Star Trek film, which was good, but not great. It was fine, it was clearly not J.J. Abrams directing. I think this was directed by Justin Lin, who I think I'm right in saying has directed several Fast and Furious films, which filled me with dread. I saw the reviews on Rotten and it looked around sort of 85%, so I decided it was worth a trip to the cinema for. And it was. It was a good film, but it wasn't a great film. There were lots of really stupid scenes, dumb shit that you feel probably would have been preventable had Abrams been in the room rather than that executive producer tag that probably means he never even visited the set. I don't really know. But either way, yeah, it was good. It wasn't great. If you had to put those movies in order, then it would be the third best of the three. Let's put it that way. Other than that, I've been continuing my woodland jogging, and I had some sort of harum scarum moment the other day where a tree root came out of nowhere and threw me arse over tit, as it were, and I was set upon. I say set upon. He was trying to help, but he was very weird. This very strange bald boy with thick rimmed glasses came to my aid, and as he reached to pick me up, I noticed he happened to be wearing some sort of Pokemon glove. So yes, he was one of those. He was in the woods looking for Pokemon. I don't think there's any Pokemon in the woods around the back of my house, but bless him. He was walking the dog as well, so I suppose it was multitasking. That's fine. He was a nice chap. And then on my way back, I saw what can only be described as an elderly lady. She was also looking for Pokemons. And I had my phone out because I was changing some tunes, and she just sort of triumphantly shouted, "Pokemon!" at me, which apparently is okay now. I haven't played Pokemon Go. I've heard some terrible things about the quality of the app. My phone doesn't actually support that app at all. It's very old and shit. And that is the reason why I haven't played it. I'd like to say the reason is that I've no interest in that whatsoever and it's for babbies, but no. I would like to give it a go, but I cannot. So I'm hoping this will die down soon because it's kind of freaking me out now. Everywhere I go, there are people wandering about grinning with their phones and everyone's being slightly too friendly for England, if you ask me. So yes, that's what's going on there. Other than that, buddies, I've been playing lots of games, although not quite as wide a variety of games as I was hoping to play, considering Ash is away and so forth, so it's kind of solo town for me, but no. We've been playing bits and bobs, and so let's head into everyone's favourite section, what I've been playing. So firstly, I'd like to draw your attention to this sad, sad time, buddies. This day was always going to come, and I've been putting it off for some time now, eking things out and trying to wring every last bit of enjoyment out of the fantastic game Doom, which I finally completed this week. Really tough, actually. Difficult at the end there. I really struggled with some of those last few battles, and it kind of throws a couple of boss battles at you that you think might be the end and then kind of aren't, and then there's more, which was much appreciated because I kept getting very sad that I was at the end and then I wasn't. So I kept playing and I kept playing. But yes, done and dusted, satisfied with the ending, and I really hope they make more Doom games now, because seriously, I think that's the most enjoyable solo campaign I've played on a video game for fucking years, absolutely ages, and just a total revelation. Can't believe how good that game is. I don't think the multiplayer is quite there to back it up at this point. I think, you know, if you get that multiplayer into the same sort of spirit of the single player, then you're talking a straight 10 out of 10 game of the year kind of thing. But for me, I just don't think it quite gets the spirit, and I think that's because they were hedging their bets. They were going for a sort of more approachable multiplayer. They played it safe with their... I think Ash said this a few podcasts ago. They played it safe with their classes and their loadouts and everything. None of that was necessary at all for Doom. And if you play the single player, then you'll completely agree. But either way, id have taken back that multiplayer now from a third-party studio, and I'm hoping that it catches up with the single-player campaign. I've no doubt I will go back through this again. Pretty much every time I log onto my console at the moment, there are several people playing through this solo campaign. It's fucking brilliant, and I'm sure we'll talk about it more when Ash has got through it, which I'm sure he eventually will. But yes, intense, like camping, and very enjoyable indeed, buddies. So also, when we had our shunt reunion a few weeks ago, you'll remember, Funk brought Far Cry 4 down on disc for me to try out, and I'm about an hour into that now, and I really enjoyed that whole intro sequence, that Pagan Min character, Troy Baker, which is baffling. Can't believe that's Troy Baker. Really weird voice that he's doing there, but he's pulling it off as he often does. Oi oi. And yeah, it's a Far Cry game, and it's very enjoyable without being spectacular, but it's kind of just opening out at this point. I've just kind of got into the open world kind of section, and yeah, really enjoyable game. So much to get my teeth into there. And that's kind of taken over from what I was planning on playing this week, which was one of Fallout and Bloodborne, because it felt really high time to go back to one of those games, having sung its praises so much and just not put enough into either of them. Fallout, not so sure about that, but I feel like I need to at least give it another go, try and get my money's worth somehow. But yeah, Far Cry 4, cool game. The other new one that I've been playing is Obliterators. We played this on game night last week before Ash went away. Funk's picked this up now as well. PJ was away, but I think he'll probably end up picking it up. It's around a tenner, something like that. I was kind of expecting a Mario Kart game here. And I suppose it kind of is, but at the same time, it's kind of reminding me more of Micro Machines or something like that, where, you know, a lot of the different game mechanics and a lot of the game ideas are to get to the front of the screen and lose your enemies off the back of it kind of thing. So very much a sort of sprint kind of kart game. And the power-ups kind of conducive to that as well. It's really fun. This is one that Ash picked up on ages and ages ago when we had our short-lived games worth investing in on Kickstarter section of the podcast, which lasted about 2 weeks. But yes, he picks up on Space Dust Racers, which was renamed Obliterators. It's been out on Steam for some time, and you can pick it up on the consoles now. And I would highly recommend doing so. It's glorious graphics and lovely art style, running at a beautiful 60 with some really interesting characters and really smooth, enjoyable mechanics. Bit of a shortage of tracks, I think. But I think you're talking four or five tracks, something like that, Whether they'll add to that or not, I'm not sure, but all of the tracks are reversible and all of them have various different weather types, which really makes a massive difference to the way that they play. So that kind of takes the edge off of that a little bit, but yeah, bit of a shortage there, but kind of makes up for it with the chaos of the fact that you can have up to 16 players on the track at one time, to the point where they've had to kind of implement a mechanic where you waggle your stick to highlight who you are at the start before the lights go out. If you waggle the analog stick, then it sort of pops up who you are, because it's very easy to lose yourself in the throng. But yeah, highly recommended this game. It's a fantastic game for very little money and a really good party game, and certainly a really good community game as well. I think that this is something that we've been trying to get back into community gaming. We've just had so much on and been on various holidays and stuff, but I think it's time to get back into the community gaming, and this could be a very good entry point indeed. So yeah, get on it and watch out for some community events that we make. So the main reason that I haven't been playing solo story mode stuff like I was intending to do was I've got a little bit addicted to F1, which I know I play F1 all the time and I don't really want to talk about it too much, but I'm very excited for F1 2016, which is out in, well, my pre-order suggests 20 days time from when I'm recording this. 2015 is a fantastic racing game. I think it's the best racing game on consoles. If you want to get into a racing game, nothing else can provide you with the sort of exhilaration of this. And unfortunately, it's really bare bones as well. Like, there's a real shortage of game modes, a real shortage of options. And it's disappointing because they took a year off when the new gen consoles came out. 2015 was the first F1 game to come out on the new gen consoles, so it was incredibly disappointing when it came out and was like a launch title, you know, launch title FIFA, where there's five fucking modes missing and then they add them next time round. And it seems like devs love to do that and pretend like they've put loads of new features in on the following one, which actually are just features that were missing from the last one and were implemented in the one before that. But yeah, I'm really enjoying this game. I've got the wheel and I've been playing through season. The career mode is non-existent, so you can do quick race and just pick your favorite tracks and choose all the different lengths of practice and qualifying and race times and so on. And it's just a lot of fun. I've just been playing a lot of this game. Three or four races a night I've been doing at sort of 25%, so sort of 20 odd laps, something like that. And just hugely enjoyable. And yeah, roll on the next one. Very excited for it. But it's prevented me from getting into any story games or anything like that this week. So, well, you know, what can you do? The night is young and the world is our mollusk, buddies. And that is what I've been playing. And now it's time for the news. Yes, we're lacking a jingle here, aren't we? But it's all right, buddies. I can copy and paste it in from a previous podcast. I won't tell you which one. Of course, there are beautiful nuances to our news every single week. Things kind of change just a little bit, but I'll pop this in now. Don't you worry. Here you go. My treat. And now it's time for the news.
The news.
The news.
The news.
The news.
Fucking news.
Sorry. Number one. Rumors emerging from reliable sources at Eurogamer about the Nintendo NX. This is kind of the major news of the week. Not much else going on, to be honest. But yeah, big news on the NX. All rumors and speculation at this point, buddies. But apparently, The NX is going to be a handheld system that plugs into your TV, powered by a mobile chipset. The chip is likely to be the NVIDIA Tegra or Tegra, depending on where you are in the world. Up in the air whether it's the X1 or the X2. The X1 is a 2015 NVIDIA chip that is currently being used for, among other things, the NVIDIA Shield, which is a remote play portable device for Steam users. Quite impressive tech, that, actually. There is an X2 chip that isn't out yet, and not much is known about it, but if that was to be the chip that they chose, then that would make a significant difference to the power of the console. So at the moment, all we have to go on for the NX's hardware is this chip, X1 or X2. If it's the X1, it's likely to be slightly less powerful than the current PlayStation and Xbox consoles. If it's the X2, it should be ahead of them, although probably not ahead of the Neo and nowhere near the sort of power of the Scorpio, for example. So we're talking about another underpowered Nintendo console here, which, I don't know. Let's get through the rest of it and then I'll tell you what I think about that. So, because of the nature of the console, this is a portable device that can dock and plug into your television. There's also talk of the controller bits of it, either side of the screen, popping off to become separate controllers for two-player gaming, which sounds novel. I'm not quite sure how that would work, but I'd certainly be interested in seeing it. Also talk of cartridges rather than discs, which makes sense because SD cards, you know, you can get huge SD cards now, relatively cheap, and no moving parts means better battery life if this is something that's going to be portable as well. Suggestions that it will transmit 1080p and 60 on televisions, and when unplugged from the televisions, drop to 720, which of course would be fine on a portable screen. It'll look pinpoint anyway. But yeah, I think that's about all we know at this point. Obviously, this is such a departure from the Wii U technology that it's unlikely there'd be any sort of backwards compatibility there. And I know Nintendo likes selling games from older systems, basically ROMs from older systems, for substantial amounts of money. But this chipset would not be able to handle emulation of Wii U games. So looks like they're cutting ties with the Wii U, which probably is fairly sensible from a business standpoint, but a little bit disappointing to the people who bought one, I suppose. I think my problem with it would be that they've made it very difficult for third-party support. So you're talking something that isn't going to be competing with it, possibly even the current consoles, let alone the half-step Neo or the two-step Scorpio. And then you're throwing cartridges into the mix as well, 32 gig cartridges, so significantly less storage space than a Blu-ray, although obviously if these things are scaled down, that might not matter. But I just wonder if they're falling into the same trap with third-party support here. Are an EA or a Ubisoft going to support this console in going into the future in a year or two's time if it's such a complete ball ache to make software for it? You're talking bespoke, completely bespoke software on carts rather than discs. Just a massive pain in the fucking ass. And I really think the death of the Wii U was that lack of third-party support. If that happens again on this, then I don't see how things will improve. I suppose the answer is, if this console is cheap, then perhaps it doesn't matter. If they're marketing this as everyone's second device, you know, not competing with an Xbox or a PlayStation necessarily, but your second console. And then maybe that would work. If it was cheap enough, you know, if you're talking sort of $179 or cheaper with a game or two, it would be tempting for a lot of people, especially a lot of people with kids, but also people like me. You know, if the Scorpio's coming out before a sort of powerful PlayStation 5 or whatever, and I'm hanging around waiting for something to spunk my money on, then maybe an NX would be the answer. PlayStation VR, I'm kind of still skeptical. certainly think VR is the future, but skeptical about that specific device and its longevity and its compatibility with consoles that aren't the Neo. I don't really know. I suppose we shall see. I'm also interested in seeing what Ash thinks about this. But yeah, at this point, that's all the information we have. Rumors of a reveal in September, possibly at the Tokyo Games Show, which is not really Nintendo style to piggyback on the back of other events. But they could certainly do something that week or around it, kind of feed off the hype of that particular expo. And I'm still really excited to see what that is. The idea of a portable and a home console, rather than the whole 3DS and home system that they've got at the moment, would give them space to branch out into mobile even more, which, you know, it looks like that's fairly successful, even if they didn't make Pokemon Go. They're dining off it quite nicely. That's what we know, and we will keep you posted on that. Just on that Pokemon Go thing as well, buddies, news that Nintendo put out some sort of statement to shareholders clarifying that they didn't make Pokemon Go. And whilst they are a 32% stakeholder in that company, Niantic, they don't expect massive profits, and they've already factored those into their current quarterly projections. This sparked an 18% drop on the day of the statement in their shares, which is massive and suggests that there's a lot of fucking idiots who bought shares not knowing that Nintendo didn't make that. You'd like to think in buying of shares, which is, you know, a kind of technical thing already, that people wouldn't be fucking idiots, but the facts don't lie. It suggests that they were fucking idiots, and a lot of people jumped ship when they realized they weren't going to see a massive payout from the game that the company they invested in didn't make. I don't know. People are fucking dumb, or I don't know, but that's what happened. There we go. Anyway, let's move on to CD Projekt Red, buddies. This is the news that CD Projekt Red wants PS4 and Xbox One crossplay, and has developed and implemented that, but is waiting for the green light from Sony. Sony are always the fucking party poopers in this. It seems like every time there's talk of crossplay or the possibility of it, we're all waiting for Sony to be like, oh yeah, okay. I don't understand. I suppose I could see why Microsoft might be more on board with that sort of thing, because they're kind of more of an open system anyway, especially with their universal platform and their PC gaming and so on, whereas Sony's kind of more closed. Maybe they feel they don't really need to open their platform to cross-play and other systems and stuff, but I can kind of understand CD Projekt Red's point of view. Obviously, they're producing a card game that they want to kind of compete with titles like Hearthstone, and Hearthstone famously is crossplay on many, many different devices. You can play between Mac and Android and iOS and all sorts. So I can totally see why they want to do that. And I suspect Sony will bite the bullet and cave here, because they'd look really bad otherwise. Especially now CD Projekt Red have kind of gone public with that fact. Which may well be a move on their part to leverage Sony into acting. I hope so. I think that having, you know, there could be problems cross-platform with certain genres of game, but certainly a card game is not one of those genres that would have a problem. So, makes sense to me, buddies, and it'd be lovely to take on some Xbox One chums. That'd be cool. So next, I don't know if you were privileged like I was to tune into the Sonic 25th anniversary livestream, buddies. What a fucking shit show that was. Amazing. If you want to see highlights of that fantastic affair, then head over to Jim Sterling's YouTube channel. He's done a super cut of the best bits in inverted commas. This was an absolute shit show. Sound cutting out, all sorts of problems. Sonic having to be led on stage because he couldn't see in his costume. I suppose the eyes didn't line up. Also, when they finally revealed what they were trying to reveal, it was playing on the net stream, but not in the building, and the presenter didn't know that the trailer was playing and talked all the way over it, which was heard on the internet by all the people who were watching the trailer, completely ruining it. Wonderful stuff. I just don't know why Sega came out of the hardware market. I don't know what happened there, buddy. It's really strange. Anyway, Sonic. Normally we wouldn't even fucking cover Sonic. We don't give a shit about Sonic. He hasn't been of any value since, I suppose, when did Sonic Adventure come out? The original, probably 2000 on the Dreamcast, something like that. A lot of people wouldn't even agree that that was a good game. I think it was great. It was certainly the last good Sonic game, if you ask me. So yeah, they've announced two new Sonic games for the 25th anniversary celebrations. One of them is a follow-up to Sonic Generations by Sonic Team, which, you know, you can blatantly just disregard because everything's been terrible for years, and that's the team that made those terrible games, so why would this one be any different just because of an anniversary? More interestingly, and the reason that I'm even continuing to speak at this point, buddies, is Sonic Mania, which is going to be a new Sonic 2D affair. This is based on the original Sonic engines, rebuilt from the ground up, featuring new levels and classic levels as well. And I'm totally on board with that. I was a Sonic kid when I was little, and I loved it on the Master System. I loved it on the Mega Drive. Sonic 2 is my favorite 2D side-scroller of all time, and they clearly can't do a 3D Sonic, or they just don't know what they're doing or aren't capable. But why not a 2D one? Why not indeed? And this is coming out on all platforms in, I think it was March 2017 was the release date. And that's cool. I'm on board. I'm well up for a new Sonic game, like a sort of sequel to Sonic 2, Sonic 3 kind of thing. Fine by me. Ignore the first one and get on board with that one. Next, some complete bollocks from Microsoft. You now have to sign into Xbox Live every 5 years, or they'll delete your gamer tag and someone else could have it. That was a strange statement for them to announce. I suppose I understand them wanting to be able to recycle gamer tags. You know, Xbox Live is massive, and they're talking about this whole universal platform and backwards compatibility on consoles going forwards. You know, in 10 years' time, you might want to be able to reclaim the gamer tags from people who bought a 360 and then moved over or whatever. But the bone of contention here, of course, is what about your purchases? Is this your whole account being closed down, or is it just your gamer tag being lost? A lot of different publications have reached out to Microsoft about this, and when I'm recording this now, I don't know for certain, but it sounds like you need to sign in every 5 years or you'll lose all your purchases as well. So if you haven't logged into Xbox Live for a while and you've got some purchases on there, buddies, then log in right now. I'm telling you to log in right now. If we're still going as a podcast in 5 years, then I will remind you again, I promise. Pinky swear. But yeah, log in to keep your purchases and your gamer tag. What the fuck are they doing here anyway, you know? I mean, they're talking about building some sort of infrastructure going forward where there's console iterations and your old software isn't getting lost. And then they're telling you that if you don't log in regularly, or semi-regularly, 5 years is definitely semi, but if you don't log in semi-regularly, you will lose all your old purchases. That doesn't make very much sense to me. Very much mixed messaging there. So, fuck knows. I don't know. Have a word, Phil. Jesus. Next, No Man's Sky does not require PS Plus membership to be played. Details are still purposely sketchy about No Man's Sky, the online components, among other things. I don't know what's going on with this game. They've clearly decided, Hello Games and Sean Murray, that no one can know exactly what's going on here. They've banked on that being a good idea. We are used to, in this day and age, knowing everything about a video game before it arrives. And being informed and then making informed purchases. And it's been a very long time since games came out, and you bought them by taking a punt, or you just bought them out of hype rather than information. Certainly, I think if you're listening to this podcast, if you listen to gaming podcasts, then you're in this camp with me. I'm not comfortable about splashing out on a game I don't know very much about, and that's why I won't be pre-ordering it. So whether they're doing damage here by being purposely fucking ambiguous, I don't really know. But from what I can work out, the game's universe is procedurally generated, but that generation is going to be across all games. So it's not actually your own private universe like it was first expected to be. This is going to be procedurally generated, but one universe is procedurally generated for everyone, and when you log into the game, that universe is ever expanding and more planets and things are being discovered, but those things are the same for all. Now, this announcement that you don't require PS Plus suggests to me that you won't be able to meet up with friends or bump into other people. They've already said that you can leave messages and you can name things and other people can stumble across those things. But I think saying it doesn't require PS Plus is the final nail in the coffin for any hopes that you could rendezvous somewhere and meet up with your friends and do whatever, this, that, and the other. Which is a shame, but at the same time, this game is so grandiose and so ambitious that I suppose we can forgive them for that. Having said that, I might just be chatting shit, buddies. I'd love to have researched it, but of course I can't because the information isn't there, and that's their decision. Who fucking knows? Sean Murray and Hello Games knows. I guess we will see. But I'll certainly be waiting for the reviews on this thing. And there's every chance I would have bought it day one had they actually informed me about it. I'm just salty because this is a video games podcast and I can't bring you information that I want to. So that's why I'm annoyed about it. Next, there is a new PS4 system update on the way. This is 4.0. And if you head to your region's PlayStation website, you can sign up. You just pop your gamer tag in. And then when the beta for this new system update goes live early August, you will have the option to download it. Sony have also said that if you don't like whatever it is, you can roll it back to the current system. No details on what this is yet, of course, but I don't know. Maybe they'll do a Hello Games and not tell us what it is, buddies. Don't even know. But we always sign up for these. It's always interesting. Something to talk about. And I think the last big update was communities, among other things. So, yeah. Normally when they do a beta, it's because there are big new features being implemented. And that's kind of exciting if you're a PlayStation gamer. So we've signed up. And I suggest you do the same. We'll be talking about it when it comes out. And, yeah, we shall see. And finally from me, although I suspect when we do talk to Ash at the end of this podcast, he'll have some favourite news things of the week. Some news favourite things of the week. It's very difficult to remember. Sorry, buddies. But finally from me, the 500 gig and 1 terabyte Xbox Ones. Xbox Ones. I just read it as it is. Xbox One S's. The 500 gig and the 1 terabyte Xbox One S's are releasing on the 23rd of August, but only in North America, Australia, and New Zealand. We do not have an EU date yet. I was kind of thinking they were going to hang on with those and hope that everyone splooged out on that 2 terabyte model, but 23rd of August it is. I expect the EU will follow suit very, very swiftly after that, but that's me for now, and that is the news. And now it's time for Fonz or Phoenix. So it's a simple Fonz from me this week, buddies, and it's kind of more of an advert, to be honest, but don't worry, it isn't Squarespace, this is for charity. That's why I'm doing this. So I'm issuing a Fonz and encouraging you to head over to Steam, if you have a decent PC, to buy Help the Game, which is a new Steam bundle, which stemmed from a charity game jam earlier in the year. So for £9.99 in the UK, or whatever that equates to in your region, you can pick up 13 new titles from a host of devs, including Team 17, Creative Assembly, Curve Digital, Sports Interactive, and Sumo Digital, among others. All proceeds go to War Child, which is a charity foundation that protects children living in the world's most dangerous war zones. So you're giving money to kids to protect them from danger, and in return you are getting 13 interesting indie games from established developers. It seems like a bit of a no-brainer to me, buddies. Bacardi and Cola, do it. So, yeah, there you go. It's a Fonz, it's as simple as that. Head on to Steam, $9.99, make a difference. Download some games. I'll certainly be doing that as well. Some of them are Mac compatible. I suspect Ash probably get involved too. And I look forward to talking about those games on next week's podcast. And now it's time for Out This Week. So it's that point in the soak, buddies, where my lover and I start to crave spiced meats. We have reached the end of the month and therefore have games for gold and PS Plus lineups. So let's get stuck into those. Don't hold your breath, though. Let's bring it down a little bit here. Let's get a bit dour and a little bit sad. Because this ain't pretty, buddies. Okay. Warriors Orokai 3 Ultimate and WWE 2K16 for Xbox One. And on 360, Spelunky and Beyond Good and Evil. Those are 360 games that are backwards compatible, although I thought Spelunky was on Xbox One already. Maybe not. Either way, unless you're a wrestling fan, that's a pretty shit month. It was a really poor month for the Xbox gamers. Although possibly better than what we're getting on PlayStation, I must say. So, PS Plus, Rebel Galaxy, Tricky Towers on PS4. PS3, we have Yakuza 5 and Retrograde. The Vita game is Papaton 3 and the crossplay game is Ultratron. So let's get stuck in here, shall we? Rebel Galaxy is—it's like No Man's Sky. It's or Elite Dangerous or something like that. It's a survival space exploration game. Quite why you chuck that into PS Plus the month that No Man's Sky is coming out? I have absolutely no idea. Now maybe playing this game will encourage more people to buy No Man's Sky. I'd imagine if you had No Man's Sky on pre-order, then you'd have played Rebel Galaxy already. I'm willing to try this game. I'll give it a go. But it does feel like a very strange time to get stuck into a space exploration game that isn't No Man's Sky, the highly anticipated AAA fucking game from Hello Games. So, weird. I think it's weird. I don't really understand. The other one, Tricky Towers, this is a versus Tetris game. So it's kind of a multiplayer Tetris game where if you don't stack your Tetris well, then everything could fall down. So it's kind of Tetris Jenga, or perhaps we could call it Tenga, buddies. That'd be good. I'd like that. So yeah, wow. Thanks. Thanks very much. Elsewhere, Yakuza 5, there was some sort of glitch. I think it was a glitch. Some mistake. It's hard to keep track of Sony's mistakes, to be brutally honest. But Yakuza 5 was free about 2 weeks ago on the store for a day. And I added it to my account. I don't have a PS3, but I thought, you know, maybe one day backwards compatibility, who knows. So I actually had that, and the fact that it's actually PS Plus makes me miserable, buddies, because you've now all got something that I've got, and I thought I was being clever. So fuck you all. But Retrograde is the other one on PS3. Fantastic. Papaton 3. Excellent. Okay, cool. And Ultratron is crossplay. Absolute, like, run-of-the-mill bog standard indie game. It's poor. It's a poor month. It's a poor month for both systems. I suppose wrestling could be a giggle, but having listened to the Video Gamer podcast with wrestling expert Simon Miller several times, I've got to say he's not a fan of that game, and he's the biggest wrestling fan I know. So, not the best. Not the best from either party. We will try these games out, of course. We always do. We'll talk about them on the show, I'm sure. Free games are free games, and we'll give them a go, but I'm not remotely excited about it, and it's so disappointing when you see that lineup and you're like, oh, brilliant. So, yeah. Just giving more and more reasons for people to say PS Plus is indie shovelware. Well done there. I do not understand why 3 years into this console cycle, we can't get some AAA games from the opening year of the system. There's plenty to choose from. They're all very cheap. It's, you know, it monetarily, you're talking a similar amount to some of the stuff that you're serving up. Just fucking give some people some AAA games, and then they'll stop moaning. Even if they aren't good games, they will stop moaning. I do not understand it. Anyway, let's move on to the other things that are coming out this week. Starting with Abzu on the PS4 and PC. This is a really gorgeous looking scuba diving exploration game. Really beautiful, sort of cel-shady, cartoony art style to it. I don't know how much this is going to be, but I watched some videos and I was fucking sold, buddies. I'd really like to check this out. Very pretty, worth YouTubing. Abzu. It's got some weird accent on the U, but I'm sure you can find it without that. Worth looking at. We also have Battleship on the Xbox One and PS4. This is a Ubisoft game. It's Battleships. It looks like a very snazzy version of Battleships, but at the end of the day, long and the fucking short, buddies, it is Battleships. So, yeah, if you like Battleships, then you won't believe what they have in store for you. Elsewhere, Cannon Brawl is coming out on the PS4. This looks fun. It's like a tower defense game. It's like a cross between a tower defense game and Worms. So it's a 2D Worms-esque sort of map, but you've got towers either side and you can deploy units and try and destroy each other's towers. It's got a whiff of free-to-play about it. I'm not quite sure what they're going for with the pricing structure here. But yes, it looks fun. I think the Yogs played it ages ago, Simon and Sips. So you can check that out if you want to know what that's like. We have Live Lock on the Xbox One, PS4, and PC. This is a top-down twin-stick shooter, sci-fi-esque, kind of Helldiver-y, Alienation-type thing, but graphically very, very pretty. Kind of blows those games out of the water. So if you like your twin-stick shooters, and let's face it, they tend to be very fun, even if they aren't well-made, this one looks gorgeous graphically and could well be worth your time. We also have Risk Urban Assault on the Xbox One, 360, PS4, and PS3. It's Risk. It's Risk. We have Batman, the Telltale series, Episode 1, Realm of Shadows on the Xbox One, 360, PS4, PS3, PC, Mac, iOS, and Android, buddies. This is out on the 2nd of August. I presume by the fact that this is coming out on tablets and phones that they haven't done anything to the engine. And I suppose we just bed in now, buddies, and assume that they will never change the engine. In 20 years from now, we'll still be talking about Telltale's shitty fucking game engine. It was shit when they first used it. It's still shit now. You either like Telltale games or you don't. I'm not knocking their storytelling ability. They got some good stuff there, but I'm really sick of them now. And I have no interest in this or Batman, frankly. So, not for me. Maybe for you. Elsewhere, we have Overcooked. It's coming out on Xbox One, PS4, and PC. This is a game that I played at Rezzed, actually, earlier in the year. It's an indie game. It is basically a sort of top-down kitchen game where you have to cook shit. You can do it multiplayer. I think that's where the fun will be here, because it didn't feel very fun to me when I played it, but I only had a couple of minutes with it, so probably take that with a pinch of salt. So yeah, it's a cooking game. You get orders that involve you doing various different tasks. Maybe take this over to the chopping board, chop these mushrooms up, then put them in this pan, then remove the pan at a certain time. It's all timing-based, sort of chore-based action. I don't know if it has online or not. It was very sort of couch co-op when I was playing it. But yeah, don't know if it's fun, but it's an interesting concept for a game anyway. And finally out this week, we have The Road to Valhalla on the PC. This is a rhythm-based Marble Madness platformer. That's what I wrote. It's showing my age there. I had Marble Madness on the Sega Master System circa fucking, I don't know, 1992, 93, something like that. But this is a sort of rhythm-based platformer where you play as a little ball, and it's kind of got that isometric look to it, so you can kind of roll around and fall off shit. It's got some of those Super Monkey Ball mechanics. And kind of the retro graphics of something like that video ball that came out recently. It looks interesting. I quite like the look of it, and I may well check it out. So there we go, buddies. That's out this week. And now it's time for the JfG Top 5. So I guess I'm cheating a little bit here, buddies. Normally this is a kind of collaborative thing, but I suppose with Ash absent, I can have my very own little top five, and it seemed therefore like an excellent time for me to get stuck into my game of the year. I know we're in July, perhaps August when this is published. Can't quite remember that, but yeah, I have games that I like, and we're well over halfway through the year now, and perhaps some of them will still be there at the end of things, and some of them won't, when we go through our exhaustive Game of the Year podcast that I'm certain Ash is very much looking forward to at the end of the year. But for now, buddies, this will be my top five. This will be my top five games of the year so far. And unlike our normal top fives, I've actually put these in order. So this is a 5-1 in order of preference, and let's get the ball rolling with number 5, Dirt Rally. So yeah, I have really enjoyed my time with Dirt Rally. I took a bit of a break from it after completely overplaying it for some time. It's quite an intense game, very demanding, and not very forgiving. And I played it fairly solidly for a couple of months, and kind of started getting a bit frustrated when I made a mistake. Of course, with these physics-based sims, the mistakes are always your fault, and it totally was my fault indeed. But yeah, I've recently gone back, and I love the way that the leaderboard system works on there, and the various online matches that you can do. Obviously, it's all ghost stuff and leaderboard stuff. It's kind of the way that a rally should be, although we did have a lot of fun playing it, playing the rallycross mode on there. They have got some circuit-based stuff. It's just only 4 or 5 tracks that they have available, but this is a fantastic game. It's worth mentioning this week, of course, because on PlayStation, at least, it's on some sort of pretty big discount. I think you can pick this up for £25 this week. Might even be less than that, I'm not sure. But I highly recommend this game. You know how much I like racing games, so you'll either take that with a pinch of salt or take that to mean I know what I'm talking about. But yes, very addictive, very unforgiving, but very rewarding as well. You get to the end of that stage, having not twanged it into a tree, you feel pretty good, buddies. You feel on top of the fucking world. So, highly recommended. That's my number five. Number four, Overwatch. This has kind of dropped down my list a little bit recently, but it's not really the fault of the game. It's kind of circumstances beyond our control. Normally, I play multiplayer games like this on a Friday game night with Funk and PJ and Ash and assorted others. And recently, we've had lots of commitments and various people have been away on this week and then that week and so on. We really haven't had many opportunities to sit down as a big group and take a whole Overwatch team. And I think that's where this shines. I don't want to play Overwatch on my own. I've never been one to jump into team shooters with randoms and actually enjoy it. I tend to just get frustrated that I can't talk to them and form tactics and rely on them like I can with my buddies who I've played games with for the last fucking 10 years or whatever. So it's not really the fault of Overwatch that I haven't played this for a few weeks, but it certainly feels, and I'm sure you'll know what I mean here if you've got it, that this game is not going anywhere. This is well supported. We've got a new character in Anna this last week or two. New modes and new levels on the way. It's going to go from strength to strength. You know what it's like with Blizzard. They're not going to toss it under the bus. So although I haven't played it for a while, I'm not too concerned about that. And yeah, it's loads of fun. It's my go-to multiplayer shooter and had to be on my list. Number three, Firewatch. Another watch, buddies. Very, very different, though. This came out back in February, which seems like a fucking age ago. It was around mine and Ash's birthdays. You know what a sucker I am for story games, especially if the scripting's good, and especially if the acting's good. This has all of those things in spades. It ran like arse when it first came out. They've since fixed that. It's very well optimized now. You don't need to worry about that anymore. Regularly going into sales as well. Well worth picking up. Just a fantastic story. Wonderful mood that it set. You really did feel like you were out in the sticks. And the conversations that you could have. The choices that you could make with dialogue. The fact that you could just remain silent and ignore people that were trying to talk to you. It was such an interesting experience. A very satisfying ending from a sort of well-rounded reality point of view rather than some sort of bombastic video gamey kind of way kind of topped things off for me. It made it feel even more authentic, and I really do suspect this will still be in my top five. I could probably say that about this one and the next two, but Firewatch is a wonderful, wonderful game. If you like story in your video games, then it really is a must-buy. Number two on my list, for many of the same reasons, because I've never been completely convinced by the mechanics, but this is Uncharted 4. Naughty Dog going from strength to strength. I think, again, wonderful story, wonderful different mechanics and mo-capping and acting, and that sells the whole thing before you even get to the gameplay. The gameplay, as such, as someone who played the Nathan Drake collection from start to finish this year, is a vast improvement on the previous Uncharted games, and incredibly enjoyable. The combat is far better, to the point where I almost stopped complaining about it completely, the shooting and stuff. It's a fabulous game. We don't need to go into too much detail here. We did a spoiler cast on this about 10 episodes ago. You can find it on our feed if you have played this and want to hear us talk about it some more. But this was always going to be in my top five. And again, I'd be very surprised if anything managed to usurp it before we got to December. But I suppose we'll see. So long-term listeners of the podcast will probably already know what my number one is. And that is Doom, buddies. The game I completed this week. As I said earlier in the show, I haven't had so much fun with a campaign for probably like a fucking decade. Unbelievable it is. Fantastic shooter. And people kind of praise it for being retro, but I think it only takes the best things from old shooters. It's retro in that respect, in the sort of health pickups, forcing you into combat kind of way, but not for the sake of it. You know, it's still got the mantling and the double jumping and the wall movements and the streamlined nature of a modern shooter. It's got everything. I think the multiplayer is slightly lacking at this point, although there's going to be some sort of double XP weekend this week coming, I think. So I'll probably be jumping back into that. We may well be playing that on game night this week. But yeah, what a fantastic fucking game Doom is. Really, really looking forward to whatever they do next. They keep rebooting these franchises, id, and going from strength to strength. And if something comes out in the second half of 2016 that is better than Doom, then fucking fair play. That will be my number one, I presume, on this list in 6 months' time. Either way, buddies, that's my top five games of the year so far. Number five, Dirt Rally. Number four, Overwatch. Number three, Firewatch. Number two, Uncharted 4. And number one, Doom. So this is where I'll sign off, buddies. You'll hear from me shortly because I'll be recording with Ash in a couple of days' time, at which point we will go through any questions that you've sent in this week and so on. I'm not going to go into detail here. I don't need to. You're going to hear from me again in literal seconds. But I hope you haven't found this solo escapade too mind-numbing, and thanks so much for listening to me sitting in my room with a couple of Cronenbergs chatting away like a prick. Catch you in a second. And now it's time for Ash's triumphant return. Hey, buddy. Welcome to episode 70 of the podcast. How you doing?
Thanks for having me on the show, buddy. It means a lot.
He's been wanting to be on this thing all his life.
I finally made it. I'm here. Huzzah. It's Friday. We're halfway through game night. I'm at least three beers in. Everything is fine, buddy. It is good.
Everything's coming up Millhouse. Funk's setting his wheel up at the moment, ready for some F1 action after this, which will no doubt be a terrible idea because normally we start with the wheel action so as not to kill each other.
Gibbons.
But nevertheless, because of the intense dedication we have to you, our wonderful listeners, we have taken time out of our game night to have a little chat on the end of the podcast. If you're still with us, that is, after the mind-numbing, miserable antics of the rest of the show.
Yeah,
but anyway,
how did you find that, buddy? Was it fun? Did you enjoy it?
It was utterly terrifying. The idea that you would sit down, press record, and speak for an hour and that be engaging was too much for me, if I'm honest. So I just kept drinking. And in the end, it wasn't so scary anymore. Whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, the listeners will find out, and I guess so will you as well. So
I'll have a listen to that. Why not?
Exciting for you to listen to the podcast, having not heard it or been part of it up until that point. So.
I'm looking forward to Out This Week, my favourite section.
You love Out This Week. Yeah.
I do, definitely.
I said, and now it's time for the news, and then I just didn't know what to fucking do. I was like, shit.
Number one, I guess. Now it's time for the news. Number one. I don't know. I'll find out.
How was your holiday, buddy? Tell me about your holiday, and then tell me what games you played on your holiday.
It was great. I went a bit north east from where I am, up to Scarborough. Went to, obviously, Scarborough, Whitby, Philly, is it, or Filey? I don't know how you say it.
Nice part of the world, buddy.
It is. It's a nice area. I mean, the weather was okay I mean, the first 3 days we were there was absolutely fantastic. So that was, it was a good time to be on the beach. Went in the sea up to my knees. It was a bit cold, not going to lie.
That'll do, pig.
There's loads of seagulls. Saw one get run over by a bus, and that was weird. You know, that made a horrifying sound. Like, yeah, that happened. Yeah. Once again, buddy, I bossed the 2p machines fucking all over that. I'm just like a natural winner when it comes to 2p machines. So
you need to go on Tipping Point with Ben Shepherd, buddy.
Maybe.
You could earn some serious dollar there.
I played a pachinko machine, buddy, as well.
What, a genuine one?
Genuine pachinko machine, which was pretty
shit the
cool.
bed, buddy. Spill the beans.
I don't know. Like, I put my money in, and that was about it. And I was like, "What is this? It's confusing." I didn't really know what to do. It flashed at me, and that was it. But yeah, 2p machines, mate. That's where it's at. You know, that's where we are in this country. I feel that's our like pachinko machines of here.
Yeah, man.
And yeah, so the technique is you scour around the arcade looking for stuff on the edge. So in this particular place, they had like tickets that you could win. Yeah, and then at the end, you put your tickets in the machine. It tells you how many you got, and then you pick a prize. In the end, we had over 400 tickets. It was amazing, and we got all kinds of sweets and shit. It was fantastic. Loads of fun.
Fucking love that. I love that shitty arcade thing, buddy.
Yeah, man.
Like, it never gets old. No matter how old you get, it's still fucking an absolute joy.
True.
It really is.
We played some skee ball. There was like some kind of machine where you have to like shoot ducks with water to get them through a hole. That gave you some tickets and stuff. It was really cool. Like there was all different machines that would give you tickets anyway. It didn't matter what it was. It was just having fun. It was cool. I really enjoyed it. We made some sick sandcastles, buddy. Some really cool ones. We bought like obviously a sandcastle making set. I didn't know these existed. But it had like your main castle, then it had like different towers you could put around it, and then the best thing was it had a bridge. You could make like a mold of a bridge. And I was like, this is just, it's amazing. For £1, this is like the best pound I've ever spent.
It sounds like some next level shit there, man.
Gibbons, buddy. And then obviously finally, just lots and lots of fish and chips being on the sea. You got to have that fish and chips, and it was beautiful.
You got to love that. Got to
love
lovely
that fish
times, and chips.
Buddy. Really enjoyed it, and yeah, had a lovely time.
Sounds like a genuine, like, old-fashioned British holiday.
Yeah, I mean, it's nice. The classic thing. Like once a year, normally, like, we go away with the grandparents because, like, they go off caravanning, so we just, like, tag along with them. It's like last year we went to like the Isle of Wight, and that was like the same experience kind of thing. Hit up the 2p machines and stuff like that. It's just loads of fun. Simple.
Nice,
I would
man.
Say.
Sounds but, like a very successful Holishlay.
Gibbons, buddy. It worked really well, and also the drive home was congestion free, which I really liked coming down the A1, and everyone going north was just like in mecca traffic, and I was like, I'm so glad I'm not in that right now. I just want to get home because it's Friday, it's game night, and I need to record some sort of podcast, or section of a podcast, I would say.
Gibbons, buddy, and we're happy to have you.
Oh, thanks,
thank
buddy.
God, in
I'm
fact.
Here.
Thank God for
yeah,
you. I can't do this shit on my own.
But yeah, so, other things that I've been doing, obviously took the tablet with me. The tablet watch, we could say this section could be, I guess.
Indeed.
It depends if you can be asked to do the reverb on your voice or not. I mean,
tablet watch.
I mean, it's there to do it if you want now, I guess.
It'd be rude not to at this point.
True. So prior to going down, I downloaded a load of the like Netflix shows. I own Netflix, or I subscribed to it, so I didn't feel bad ripping them off, even though, you know, I'm paying for it anyway. I didn't have any Wi-Fi or anything where I was, and I knew that. So, but I downloaded the season of Stranger Things. Have you heard about this, buddy?
I've heard a lot of hype about this actually recently.
It's very cool. Like, I don't like scary that, do you? Things, but I could just about cope with this. A lot of people saying it's like Stephen King or whatever it is, like 80s, like thriller kind of scary shit like that, you know.
I can't remember. Was it Giant Bomb that were talking about this on their podcast?
I don't know, buddy.
You might not have heard it because you've been away. I'm pretty sure that this week's Giant Bomb, actually, they were talking about that show. So you might want to listen to that.
Oh, cool.
I've got
one episode to get through. So I'm going to watch that maybe tonight. I don't know. I might be a bit pissed. Who knows? But really, really enjoying that. So like, I've watched, I think it's like 7 of the 8 episodes. The soundtrack is awesome. Really, really cool. Like 80s, just fantastic like sounds. Like even like the stuff that they made for the show, like the intro, like or the credits or whatever it's called, it's just really, really cool. It's kind of modern but still 80s. Like being like a guy that deals with a lot of sound in his job, it's I highly recommend it just because it sounds wicked
nice, man. I'll have to look into that.
Definitely, buddy. So now I guess I talk about the games I've played, because mainly...
Well, I just want to briefly mention we're talking about Netflix, my intense fucking hugely girly excitement at the 2-minute Gilmore Girls teaser video that went up this week from Netflix.
Holy shit.
Holy shit, that thing's coming out in a couple of months' time. Me and the missus need to step up our regime on the whole Gilmore Girls because we're only on season 3.
Mate.
I'm not waiting for her, buddy. When that thing comes out, all bets are off. So she needs to buck her ideas up. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, and obviously she listens to this podcast, you know.
Religiously,
yeah, that's the word.
Yeah. No, not for at least a year and a half. I think the last one she listened to was the one she was on.
Ah, well, so, that will happen. Like, you know, no one likes to hear their own voice. I mean, we have to edit it and listen to it on a weekly basis.
Yeah.
And I hate every minute, buddy. I'm not going to lie.
I think she listened to make sure we didn't make her sound stupid.
Maybe. That will happen. Fair. I mean,
anyway, tell us about the games you've been playing, buddy. You've been in Mobile Town, so
yes.
What have you got?
I've played 4 main games that I will talk about. I did a tiny, tiny bit of VTarding, but not a lot. I thought I'd play that a lot more, to be honest. But yeah, I was just, obviously, like, I was fresh with the tablet. I installed a few games on there, and I was ready to go. So the main one that I played was Civilization Revolution number 2, or just, yeah, not number 2, just 2. That would make more sense.
I've heard real mixed things about this. Like, some people think that it benefits greatly from being sort of... some people have kind of disparagingly called it a sort of dumbed-down version, and other people have kind of embraced the simplicity of it. Where do you kind of come down on this?
Well, I was quite a big fan of the original Civilization Revolution, which I played a lot of on the 360. I was like, wicked, I can finally play Civ on a console. And it worked reasonably well. It was fine. Like you say, it's very much a simplified version of it. But this number 2, I'm going to call it, as in, that. It's good. It's got enough in there, I would say, to keep you intrigued in, like, Civ itself. But, you know, that it is missing a fair chunk of stuff you can do with your cities. I found the moving of, like, your infantry and stuff like that, that was fine. And being able to swap out, so, like, on a tablet, you just hold down over the person and then it would select them, and then you tell them where to go and then you confirm it, kind of thing. The being able to hold characters and things in certain places, I would lose where they are because navigating through the world isn't as smooth, obviously, with like a mouse and keyboard, which I kind of missed.
So do you think that... How do you think the... how you enjoy the game is affected by the fact that you're a bit of a, I suppose, Civ veteran maybe isn't the word, but you know, you've got a real history with this game. You've played a lot of Civ 5, you've watched a lot of Civ 5.
Yeah, yeah.
The fact that this is a bit of a different animal, how is that kind of... Do you think that it's better or worse? Do you think someone who's never played Civ at all would prefer this to someone who's like a bit of a veteran? Or do you think that you kind of understand where they've simplified and kind of can appreciate that?
Yes and no, I guess. I don't know. They've definitely simplified it, I would say. But in a way that there's still quite a lot of depth to it. It's not as simple as the original Revolution, I would say. It's a good game. It's like, I don't know, it's Civ on a tablet. I mean, what more do you want, really, in a nutshell? I just really enjoyed the fact that I could play this game. On the tablet I've got, I can run Android and Windows 10, and I had Civ 5 installed on this tablet like last December when I got my first one. And I played a couple of games on it, and firstly, it didn't run great because obviously it's a tablet. It's not going to be able to run it super smooth.
Yeah, totally. And
also, like, even though there is a mode in it for touchscreen, it's not fantastic. Whereas, obviously, this game is designed to be played on a touchscreen. And also, it's the same game that's been released on the Vita. Do you remember me saying, or when we said out this week, you know, my favourite section, we had that XCOM come out on the Vita and also Civ, this game, come out on the Vita at the same time.
Yeah, I mean, Ellen's played a great deal of Civ on the Vita. She really enjoyed it as well.
Yeah, it's the exact same game. And, as you said, she's enjoyed it. And I just really, yeah, I loved having Civ in a mobile form. It was just another platform to play Civ on, really. I mean, yes, like you say, it's dumbed down, but it's still an enjoyable game, I would say. And
I think so, yeah. You can take it in both ways. Like, you can call it dumbed down, and I suppose purists might do that, but at the same time, you have to understand the limitations of the device that you're playing it on. It's not necessarily dumbed down. It's simplified, and you could even describe dumbed down as optimized in this instance. So,
yeah, true.
That sounds really cool, man. Sounds good.
Gibbons, Bunny. I just, you know, it makes me think, like, why can't they even just like port some version of this game onto like the PS4 or Xbox One, just to have something there, you know, like, because we would play that even. Like, it'd be because it, even on my tablet, like, this game ran not as smooth as I would like it. I'm sure on the Vita, it runs a lot better. And, you know, if you chuck this, like, onto the PS4, like, it would be smooth as fuck. And, you know, probably only about £8, which is, I think that's how much I paid for it on the App Store, about £8. And, yeah, it's quite expensive for an app, but, you know, I wanted to play
Civ. But it's got that pedigree, buddy. So you know it's
exactly,
worth it.
Yeah. I knew it was going to be good. So, yeah.
Totally, man.
Civ, buddy. It's cool. I love Civ. Civ's awesome.
Sure is.
Gibbons. Like I said to Funk the other day, or last week, I can't remember. It was the Google app or the Google game for 10p, and that was Carcassonne, buddy. And fuck me, how cool is Carcassonne? I've forgotten how good that game is. It's such a good board game. Really,
it's
really
another
is.
One of these games that we used to play on the 360. Yeah. And then when I met my missus, she had the actual board game. Yeah. So we actually play Carcassonne quite regularly. She's got the expansion pack where you can put pigs in the fields. Yeah. And builders in the fucking cities and
yeah,
stuff,
you can buddy. Pay extra and get all the expansion packs on the app, but like I was just playing bog standard Carcassonne, and oh, it's so good. Like I started playing, I was like, I'm not going to remember any of the rules, and immediately I was like, yes, I'm going to take over this road. Right, he started to build a bit of a castle. If I put one this side and put a man in, and put one that side and put a man in, I can overthrow him, and that castle's mine. I was like, this is awesome.
Sign of a good game, buddy, where you can just fall back into
it
like that.
Yeah, seriously. Like, It's a good version as well on the App Store. Very easy to, you know, do with your fingers. Just point and there it goes. And yeah, like I must have played about, like, I don't know, 9-10 games of that. And, you know, like I started off just 1v1. And I was like, I'll step it up. You know, three people in there, because you can add up, I think it's up to like 5 AI characters. I think it is anyway. And so, yeah, it was just lots and lots of fun. Very cool game. Enjoyable.
Nice, man. Good stuff.
Strange game now, buddy. Do you remember ages ago I bought that Game Dev Tycoon? Was it Game Dev Tycoon? I can't remember if that was the name. You know, where you build, like, you're a game developer in your basement and you have to build games and, you know, you get
bigger. I watched a whole series of Sips playing that game. So, yeah. Yes, absolutely.
So, I found a game called Fizz, Brewery Management Game, which is pretty much the exact same, but you brew beer and sell it in different pubs.
That sounds fucking cool.
It's so, like, mind-numbing. Like, literally, you're like, pick the ingredients, start brewing, get a quality of whatever number, sell it, try and make a profit, and then you can go into, like, looking at you can sell your beer at different bars, and you can see what kind of people, what, like, types of ale they drink at different bars, and how much they'll play, like, a low, a medium, and a high quality beer and stuff like that. And then, like, later in the game, you'll find, like, there's seasonal places, like, there was, like, a surf shop, or surf shack, sorry. And that would only pop up during, like, the summer season. But you could get a massive return there because people would pay a lot more for your beer, especially if it was a good quality one. It's a total numbers game. But I must have played, I don't know, about 2 hours of this game, like, through the week. And it was just, I don't know, so pointless, but I just enjoy just going, like, yeah, my beer's getting better. And then, like, you can enter your beers into, like, different competitions and stuff like that. It was cool. I think it was only like 80p or something on the store.
But sounds like a good app for Funk's trip up north.
Yeah, it's a massive, massive time wasting game. It's so pointless. It was
nice.
Yeah, buddy. And the last game that I played briefly, but I feel like I should say something about it, is Hitman Sniper.
So, oh yeah, this is one you were talking about before you went away, actually, this one.
Yeah, I've played a bit more of it, and I really like it. It seems like everything kind of just happens, like, you've got one level, and you have, like, different targets each time. But then there's, like, bonus objectives, like shoot a guy and make him land in, like, the hot tub or something like that, or take out these two guys without being seen or something like that. So you are just literally up in a mountain looking over this entire level, like, I think it's just like a boat and then people all around it, and you zoom into your sniper and then that's your view, obviously, and, like, you swipe left and right and you can hold your breath and take stealth shots and things like that. And obviously after each game, I'll call it, I don't know what it's called, I can't remember what it's called in the actual game, is each time you do a mission, we'll say, you get points the way you can upgrade your gun or upgrade your breathing and stuff like that. It's a really cool game. It's a great time waster. It looks like you can take this game a lot further than what it is when you first see it. There's a lot more to it, I would say, than
it sounds like it's it could be a really good VR game with the whole static position thing and the looking around and zooming in and stuff. Sounds like it'd be really conducive to, like, PlayStation VR or something like that.
That's not a bad shout, to be honest, buddy. That'd be quite cool. Yeah.
Because half the problem with shooters is that you can't move in VR, you know, without moving your stick or whatever. And they have the Vive stuff with the teleporting and that sort of thing. This sounds like the perfect fucking antidote to any sort of movement, like a sniper position.
Yeah. Why not, buddy? You're up in the mountain. It's just, yeah, and you just look around. Totally.
Gibbons. Nice. Yeah,
I'll play that for a fiver. Why not? But I think I only paid like 50p for that, obviously in some sort of sale. Mainly I buy stuff when it gets cheap. I don't like paying full price.
Beautiful stuff, buddy. Beautiful stuff.
Gibbons, buddy. And the bit of V-tarding I did, I played a bit more of the Swapper, which I really want to finish, especially now that I remember the mechanic where you can slow down time. That really helps. And I tried some one of your favorite games or games you really enjoyed, which was Velocity 2X. And I tried playing that, and I was just like, my brain cannot work at these kind of speeds anymore. Like, literally.
It's a steep learning curve, but once you get it, it's incredibly addictive.
Yeah, I gave it a go for half an hour, and I was like, no. Like, there's too much for me to... I like the fact that you control how quickly it scrolls kind of thing. I like that.
Yeah, absolutely.
But, yeah, that hurt my brain, so I stopped.
I feel like... having the big screen might be a massive advantage there. I think perhaps playing that on the console might be a good idea.
Yeah, because, possibly.
It is a sort of lots of things going on, lots of things to think about type game. So, yeah.
Gibbons, yeah,
buddy. That's cool, buddy.
Well, yeah. So that wraps up my week in games. I know I rambled on a bit there, but, you know, tablet watch, buddy.
It's all good, buddy. No worries whatsoever. Every week, we end the show with questions and comments sent in by you. If you've got anything for us, just pop an email to the jfgpodcast@gmail.com or contact us on Facebook, Twitter, or at justforgamers.co.uk. So let's finish things off with a bit of Street Beat, buddy. JfG Street Beat.
It's fucking JfG Street Beat.
You got a question we want to know. Street Beat. Facebook, Twitter, we're on them all, so hit us up and be on the show. Street Beat. The JfG Street Beat.
Do you like that jingle?
I do. I probably just popped it in. So, yeah, absolutely. So. I like that jingle, buddy.
Yeah.
We got some Bobs. We got a couple of questions from JJ, and we got one from Bob. Well, Bob's is more of a tale that he sent me that I thought that needed an airing because it's an example of a different kind of... way of looking at things, which I quite liked. So anyway, let's get the ball rolling with JJ. It's worth mentioning that JJ's first message, he was allegedly drunk, and his second message, he apologized for being drunk in his first message, but I really couldn't tell the difference. He was very eloquent in both of them. So
I was going to say, could have gone the other way there, buddy.
Could have gone the other way there, buddies, but I got in there. It's fine, nice. Don't worry. So firstly, JJ says, so after completing South Park, I realized, other than how good it was, that it was satisfying to actually finish a game.
Yay.
I was just intending to check out. This is a cautionary tale and obviously a perfect example for you, buddy, because you rarely get the time to finish shit. So this could be kind of something good for you. Cool. The game got better the longer I played, and things I would have missed if I just stopped and said good game halfway through.
Yep.
JFG gave me the heads up on South Park, so I would like you and or the listeners to help me whittle the backlog. So he's got some games that he needs to play through, and he'd like us to try and prioritize them for him. So
what? And he wants to complete them as well.
Yeah, what's his best route through this selection of games here? Okay.
So
we're tackling the Vita first. He's got Bastion, Shovel Knight, and Axiom Verge.
I mean, I'd say Bastion as one of my first because I really enjoyed that game. The narrator is just the best. Like, seriously, I've never experienced anyone better than that guy. He's awesome.
Yep. I would say Bastion is... As someone who likes that game, I can never remember the name of it. It's like a blind spot in my existence. Transistor.
That's the one, buddy.
I would like to play Bastion, so maybe you should play Bastion. Shovel Knight is a sort of 2D roguelike, isn't it? Where you sort of bounce on enemies. Axiom Verge, very sort of 16-bit sort of throwback game, quite difficult. I'd imagine out of the three, Bastion's probably the easiest.
I would say so.
Perhaps the easiest is the best place to start, JJ. Maybe you could get through that first and feel a sense of accomplishment despite the fact that the difficulty was lower. As I understand it, Axiom Verge is very difficult to complete. And Shovel Knight as well is no mean feat either. PS4 he's got Metro Redux, Infamous Second Son, Dragon Age Inquisition, and Wolfenstein The Old Blood.
I've literally forgotten what the first one was, and the second.
Metro Redux.
And the third, and the fourth.
Infamous Second Son. It's difficult for us to answer these because we've kind of got allegiances to certain games and we've got things that we think about the others. So for me, we've been considering buying Dragon Age because it's like a fiver on the store in the EU at the moment.
Yeah, I'm going to buy that.
Probably going to happen.
It's gonna
Wolfenstein
happen.
The Old Blood, is that the expansion? Is that the DLC? Or is that the full game?
You've got my whatever it is. I gave it to you.
Did you? The New Order.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's the expansion. So if you're desperate to get through shit, then disregard the expansion, because if you completed that, you wouldn't feel like you completed a proper game anyway, so we can discount that. Discount Infamous because it's fucking dull. So I would go for Dragon Age or Metro there, but this is very much a personal preference type thing.
Infamous, what was the one that we got?
First Light.
I enjoyed that for a while. I mean, I didn't go back to complete it, which I said I probably was going to.
I just feel like that world is empty. There's just not enough in it, you know?
True. Like, Metro, I just can't play that. I played the first one and got scared, so stopped. It's still sitting there on my Steam account. One day I might play it, but probably won't.
I will play that one day, but now is not the time. JJ also says, sadly, this is only a few of the games he's got in his backlog. if you like, I'll let you know what I think, or I'll just shut up and play the games. Thanks, JJ. P.S., fucking Trials has got to fit in somewhere, so maybe not Dragon Age just yet. While you've been away, buddy, I've had regular stuff on my What's New section of JJ breaking records on Trials. So just a word of warning there, FYI.
Well, you know for a fact that Trials Fusion was never my forte. I just went round, got the gold medals, and left it at that. But you know, I might have to.
You're talking most of your records are single runs. Most people think when they look at them that they couldn't possibly be single runs because they're too good, but you are that good, so that's why they look so good.
Now what happened?
That's a bit of a disadvantage to you.
Yeah.
Next one from JJ. I'm not sure either of us are in any way able to answer this, but anyway, he says, I was like so many other teen boys that their first great JRPG was Final Fantasy VII. To this day, I can remember so much of that game like it was yesterday. In the waning hours of the game, my trusty PS1 memory card corrupted and all was lost.
Never
Genova did. Wins. I haven't been able to touch a game longer than a few hours since and foregoing all JRPGs. Has an experience like this ever turned you off of a genre completely? JJ. So he's avoiding all JRPGs because of that terrible instance when his PS1 memory card
died. I'd probably just avoid JRPGs in general.
Well, that's because you
can't get on with them. I've tried so many times. I mean, we were talking to Funk about MMOs and stuff earlier, and I was just like, I really want to play them, but I just can't find it. And I feel the same with like a JRPG. Like, I want to get into one, but there's just I've tried so many and they never fit with me. I don't know.
I've decided that this is a genre I need to get into, and I have seen my entry point, buddy, in the name of Persona.
Okay. Possibly.
I am gonna get Persona and I'm gonna play through Persona.
If you get it, I'll get it.
The new one.
Yeah.
Persona 5 when it comes out. I was listening to another podcast, PSR UK, and they were talking about it, and he was saying that you don't need to have played the other ones to understand the new one. It's new characters every time in a game world that is familiar. So you don't need to have some sort of like previous knowledge of things, and it's time that I gave one a go. So that's where I'm jumping in.
I'll do that with you.
But yeah, I haven't really played any. I never got into Final Fantasy. I played the demo of Final Fantasy VII on my PC in about 1998, and I didn't understand the hype or what was going on or anything, but I didn't really give it a chance. I was playing weird shit like fucking Carmageddon and Mage Slayer at the time. So, I don't think anything's ever put me off an entire genre, to be honest, without me already being completely uninterested in that genre to begin with.
Yeah, so, I just said being some kind of schoolboy bitch puts me off horror games for life.
Yeah, that's a different thing though, isn't it? That's a bit of a different thing.
Definitely. But I've never been put off a genre, I would say. I had my GTA 3 save corrupted when I was at, like, I don't know, just shy of like 100% in that game. Like, I'd done everything and I was just collecting whatever it was. I don't think it was pigeons back then. I can't remember. It was something anyway. The, you know, like the little things you have to go around the whole entire map to collect. And
yeah, Gibbon.
And yeah, that fucked on me. I was not happy. I didn't have a backup or anything of it. I was so many hours put into that. Just wasted. Just fucking never went back to GTA 3 after that, obviously.
Yeah, I've been pretty lucky with my games. I don't think I've ever been in a situation where I've lost all my progress. So I think I'm very, very lucky in that respect. I've never had like a memory card die or a save game. Closest I came was, I think, Tomb Raider 3, where I got stuck in a situation where it auto-saved just as I was about to die and I lost the whole game. But
cool.
It wasn't a great game anyway, buddies, so I wouldn't worry.
That sucks, buddy.
It was annoying.
Gibbons.
Got repeatedly murdered by a barracuda.
Whoa. Surprise
in
murder.
The end. Barracuda. I think in the end I got a save game off the internet that, like, from just before where I was or something like that. So
I missed the internet this week, buddy.
I'm sure. It's been painful. I couldn't live without it now.
No, me neither.
Let's finish things off. Finish things off from something from Bob. Not really a question as such, but more his experiences of late. So Bob says, just had a little thought after your last pod. I think he's referring to the podcast where I said I'd been playing 360 games.
Yeah.
Still using my 360 from time to time because I have a hard drive full of sweet gaming relish. But I also recently controversially picked up a Wii. Ooh. Crazy, I know, but here's the thing. I bought one from CEX with Mario Kart 2 controllers and 2 steering wheels for £30, which is stupidly cheap.
That's worth it.
I game on a fairly tight budget, as do we all, and there's a wealth of quality games available at low, low prices. I used to run out and get the latest games, but now I get a much bigger buzz from picking up cheap games on a budget. Where is the need to update purchases? Why feel compelled to buy anything at full price? That's Bob. What do you make of that, buddy?
Yeah, the Wii's still good. I mean, we've still got one kicking about, and we use it on a semi-regular basis. I wouldn't say there's a wealth of content on the Wii. There's a selected few games, and like, even like looking around for like these games, like on the Wii, like I think I was looking for like one of the Mario games, like the simple, I can't remember which one it was, you know, where it's 2D but 3D, that classic 2.5D side scroller. <Yeah. laughs> Oh, he's back. And for the Wii, I can't remember which one it was, but I was looking for that, and that was like, the cheapest I could find it was like 20-25 quid. I was like, for fuck's sake, this game's like old and it's on the Wii, which is shit. This should be like £2. So like, I understand, like, yeah, there is a wealth of like old content for these previous consoles and stuff, but sometimes it's a bit weird, like the pricing of them. I don't get it. It's odd.
I think for me, what it comes down to, as someone who's been playing 360 games, and I'm still playing 360 games and I'm enjoying them, is it comes down to your gaming habits and who you play with. Because These old games, a lot of them, the servers are gone. If you're playing online games, then you kind of, there's an incentive that you kind of feel like you need to stay kind of on at least vaguely recent so that you can continue to play games with friends. And
yeah,
I can't really go back, and a lot of the servers on games that I used to love are gone now, so it wouldn't even be an option to continue playing them, and therefore it kind of makes sense to keep moving forward with the times and keep playing games as they come out. Also, yeah, I'm a sucker for great graphics as well, which I can't get away from at all. I totally understand, like, and certainly if you've got a couple of gamers in the house with you, then there's a wonderful wealth of software to be played. I still occasionally play my Mega Drive, so there's lots of great stuff there. But yeah, it's kind of a toss-up. I think there's room for both. I think there's room for picking up very cheap old stuff and enjoying new stuff as well. That's kind of where I come down on it.
Yeah, totally. I mean, I'm a fan of all games if they're good, in all ways.
Exactly. Some games don't age. Some games are just fucking perfect forever.
Yeah, that's another thing on the tablet. I've got a couple of emulators on there now as well. I took Pokemon Blue with me on the Game Boy emulator. I didn't get around to playing it, but, you know, obviously all this like talk of Pokemon Go, I was like, no, I'm going to go and catch some proper Pokemon. I'm not going to walk around with my phone. I saw so many people walking around like on the beaches and stuff with their phones out. I'm like, oh, just die. Just die already.
Yeah, man. You listen to the first half of this podcast and you'll hear some similar tales. I promise you that.
Nice, buddy. Cool. But yeah, definitely old gaming, even though it's not that old. Like, you know, there's a wealth of games out there. And yeah, if you've got the time to play them, go for it. If you don't want to go for the latest releases, go for it. But I, like you say, I'm a sucker for the latest and greatest, and that's what I want most of the time, buddy.
Agreed, buddy. Gibbons, full blown. So I think that'll about do us, buddy. Thanks so much for joining us for this last section. Very kind of you to take time out of your game night. I'm saying that as if it's not mine as well.
Yeah, it's not yours, it's mine.
Funk's like driving around the fucking Nürburgring right now going, what the fuck, where are they?
So yeah, we 45 need to go minutes late, we're still him. Going. Oops.
Yeah, Gibbons. Cool, buddy. We'll play some games this week. We need to get into Soma this week, among other things. I'm very
Heads
excited
up, buddy.
That.
This week, while I was away, I got invited to the Elder Scrolls Legends beta, so I've installed it now on the computer, and hopefully I will report back.
Nice, looking forward to hearing about that as well.
Gibbons B, me too.
Sweet buddy. Cool. Well, thanks very much for listening, everyone, if you still are. you can find us at www.thejfgpodcast. No, I've done it again. www.justforgamers.co.uk. I caught it quicker this time, though,
nice,
didn't I?
Nice, well played, yeah. I didn't
we
even
We need to buy that other domain. I'm sure it's available.
Probably.
You can find us at Facebook/TheJFG Podcast. Twitter, our @ is @TheJFG Podcast. You can find us on SoundCloud/JustForGamers. YouTube, search the JFG Podcast. PlayStation, search the JFG Podcast. And we are also on Google+, if that is how you choose to live your life. Thanks so much for listening, buddies. We'll be back with a full show next week. until then, I've been Alex. He has been Ash.
Goodbye.
Goodbye, buddies. Goodbye. You've been listening to the JFG Podcast with Ash and me, Alex. To find out more, head to www.justforgamers.co.uk, Facebook/TheJFG Podcast, or Twitter, where we are @TheJFG Podcast. Episodes go live every Sunday, and if you could pop onto iTunes and write us a quick review, we would love every inch of you, even if you got old and fat. Thanks so much for listening, and we will catch you next time. Thank you.